Today, we are going to continue our study in the book of Hebrews. So if you have your Bibles with you, if you'll turn with me over to Hebrews chapter 1. So today, I knew a lot of folks were going to be out. So we're only going to cover a couple of verses today, but these verses are theologically pregnant with all kinds of implication. And so I thought we might continue to slow down here as we have been going through chapter 1 and really get the nuance of what the writer here is speaking of. Now, the thing that we have to remember whenever we study the book of Hebrews, or really any book, is that it has to be viewed through a lens. And the lens that we need to view the book of Hebrews, or any other book in the Bible, the lens that we need to use is really the central theme of the Bible, and that is what? The kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is the Bible's central theme. Unless we have forgotten that, just a couple of reminders, one from Dr. Pentecost from Dallas Seminary. He says the great theme of God's kingdom program can be found throughout the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. It is the theme that unifies all of Scripture. In addition, Tony Evans, who is the pastor of Oak Cliff Bible Church, also a graduate of Dallas Seminary, notes this. He says, the unifying central theme throughout the Bible is the glory of God and the advancement of His kingdom. The conjoining thread from Genesis to Revelation, from beginning to end, is focused on one thing: God's glory through advancing God's kingdom. So again, what Pentecost and Evans are saying is that we all have a grid or filter by which we read the Word of God, and what we're encouraging and what the Scripture encourages is that we view that through the concept of the kingdom. Now again, just to refresh you, a kingdom has three basic elements. A kingdom has to have a ruler. A kingdom has to have a realm, that is, a sphere in which that kingdom authority is exercised. And then, for there to be a kingdom, there has to be rulership. A kingdom must involve the exercise of ruling and reigning or governing. Now, today, we're going to look again at just a couple of verses, Jesus' position over the angels. When we come back next time, we're going to look at verses 8 and 9, Jesus' purpose over the angels, and then in verses 10 through 14, Jesus' preeminence over angels. Now, when we're talking about, and what the author of the Hebrews is speaking of, is that he's talking about the office of sonship, the office of Christ's sonship. So when we think of Jesus, we know that He is God. We know that He has all of the attributes of God. He is the eternally supreme being. He is eternal glory. He is eternally God. He is eternally perfect. You'll recall that during the incarnation, when He was in the garden the night before He was to be crucified, He prayed a prayer to the Father. One facet of that prayer, and we see this in verses 3 and 5 of John 17, when He prayed, "This is eternal life, that they may know You, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom You have sent. I glorified You on the earth, having accomplished the work which You have given Me to do. Now, Father," watch this, "glorify Me together with Yourself, with the glory which I had with You before the world was." Speaking of before the incarnation, when there was just Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As important as that is not what the author of Hebrews is trying to labor in his various arguments. You'll recall the main reason why the writer to the Hebrews is writing to these Jewish believers is because they had been Christians for several years and they were running into immense adversity, so much so that many of them were tempted to leave the faith and go back to Judaism, their former way of life. And the appeal to this congregation from the author of Hebrews is, don't do that. fundamentally because there's no place else to go. And so he begins immediately in chapter 1 by saying, in the past times, God has spoken through various forms and prophets and so forth, and yet in these latter days has spoken to us through his Son, the full and final form of God's revelation. And so what he labors in this argument are several reasons why Christ deserves our allegiance, our obedience, and not abandoning the Christian life. So the author to the Hebrews talks about Jesus' taking on humanity, that he grew in wisdom and favor with God and man, that he lived a sinless life, that he died and was resurrected, and that he secured the salvation of men, and one day he will be appointed to rule over the universe. So we're talking about the incarnational ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what the author to the Hebrews is laboring, and we'll see that here in just a second. So again, he's comparing, contrasting, and then demonstrating how Jesus is superior to the angels. Now, why pick angels? Well, the Apostle Paul notes in his letter to the Colossians that there was some issue with people venerating angels in the churches. That's particularly associated, or will be at least in the second century, with Gnosticism. That is possibly one reason why he starts with the argument, but more likely than not, remember that the law of Moses in the Old Testament was mediated through angels. In other words, they were in some measure being used by God to dispense truth to the children of Israel. And so it's this point, I think, that the author to the Hebrews is using to demonstrate how Jesus is superior to the angels. So don't fall away. In other words, don't esteem angels. And he does that in verse 5 by demonstrating and looking at Jesus is the Son and the true Messiah, the anointed one, and then in verses 6 and 7 that Jesus is superior in ministry to the angels, therefore he is higher than the angels. Now, in the rest of this chapter, there's going to be arguments made from really seven places in Scripture. Some have a double reference, but he's going to use the Old Testament to demonstrate how Jesus is better than anything in the Old Testament, and that really he is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. That is, the author says to us that Jesus was declared Son by the fulfillment of the resurrection. Now, when you say declared Son, what do you mean declared Son? Isn't he the Son by nature? In other words, in terms of his being, he is the Son. Yes, that's true, but again, remember the writer is talking about the office of sonship, dealing with Christ as priest, prophet, and king. Notice what the writer says in verse 7. For to which of the angels did he ever say, "You are my Son, today I have begotten you"? That's a quote from Psalm 2:7 that he's using here in verse 5. So the title of Son that the author is using has to do with Jesus' position of authority, not his birth, not that moment in time when he was born to Mary. Paul makes this similar statement over in Romans chapter 1 when he writes, Jesus, that is the object of this sentence, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead, according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, the word declared here, horizo, is the word that it comes from in the Greek, and it means to be appointed or designated. To be appointed or designated. Dr. Radmacher notes the word translated means to be designated. That is, Jesus did not become Son of God by the resurrection. Instead, the resurrection proved that Jesus was the Son of God. Paul notes this in Acts. He says, "And we preach to you the good news of the promise made to the fathers, that God has fulfilled this promise to our children, in that he raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. So what does this mean? Well, Pentecost notes that without a doubt, this is referring to the day of Jesus' resurrection, fulfilling the mission which God had sent him to do. And then he adds, just as Jacob in the Old Testament appointed Joseph to an authoritative position, and Joseph became the son or the heir. So whenever you talk about in the scriptures this issue of becoming son, what he's referring to is the one and to whom the inheritance belongs. Traditionally in the Old Testament, under the Mosaic law, a father and mother could have many children. The firstborn was set aside, generally, to be the inheritor. As such, he would receive a double portion of a blessing or inheritance. Many people would say, or the younger brothers and sisters might say, well, that doesn't seem very fair. He's the oldest, he gets a double portion. But you'll recall during the biblical times, they didn't have what we have today, which is known as Social Security, which I don't know why they call it Social Security. It's not enough to be social on, and it definitely doesn't have security. And so in the Old Testament, when the oldest would get the double portion, that extra portion was to be used by him to support the parents. And so what we find that the author is doing is much like what we see in the story of Jacob and Joseph. That is, Joseph became an heir or the son at a specific time. Now the chart up here, and I emailed these notes to you guys, so if you look in your email account, you should see them there. But we know that Jacob, who God later changed his name to Israel, had 12 sons, Joseph being the 11th son. And yet Jacob is the one who blessed Joseph and gave him the inheritance as son, that is the firstborn. For example, over in Genesis chapter 48, Moses, who writes the book of Genesis, says this in 48 verse 21. Then Israel, that is Jacob, said to Joseph, behold, I am about to die, but God will be with you and bring you back to the land of your fathers. I give you one portion more than your brothers, double portion of inheritance, which I took from the hand of the Amorite with my sword and my bow. And so the impetus for this then is to that Jesus, like Joseph, who was declared to be the firstborn, with all the rights of the inheritance, Jesus is the firstborn who is deemed worthy to receive the inheritance from God. So going back to our verse, he says, I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. So how is Jesus then the fulfillment of this psalm, which is used by the writer to the Hebrews, is also used by the Apostle Paul? Well, let's go back and look and just kind of review. It's only 12 verses. You can look at it up here. Psalm number 2 is referred to as an enthronement psalm. An enthronement psalm. Notice what the psalmist writes. He says, why are the nations in an uproar, and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us tear their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he will speak to them in his anger and terrify them in his fury, saying, but as for me, I've installed my king upon Mount Zion, my holy mountain. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will surely give the nations as your inheritance. Again, all of this has to do with the end times. Man raising his fist up against God. God the Father and God the Son, who is the Messiah, what? What do they do? In response, they laugh at these scoffers. Notice what he says. Today I have begotten you, ask of me, and I will surely give the nations as your inheritance and the very ends of the earth as your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron, something that the writer to Revelation, John the Revelator writes. Remember in Revelation chapter 19 when they said the Lord will return and out of his mouth will come a sharp sword with which he will strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a what? Rod of iron. You shall shatter them like earthenware. Now therefore, O kings, show discernment. Take warning, O judges of the earth. Worship the Lord with reverence and rejoice with trembling. Do homage to the Son, that he not become angry and you perish in the way. For his wrath may soon be kindled. How blessed are those who all take refuge in him. So that's what the author is referring to in Hebrews, back to this enthronement psalm. Again, the emphasis is upon what? Christ coming back to rule, but in what context? Well, that's always been determined for us too. If you think back to the Old Testament, how has it been demonstrated to us? By the fact that of the covenants that we have in the Old Testament. Remember in Genesis chapter 12, God came to Abraham and said he's going to grant him land, seed, and blessing. And that the further advancement of these promises were fulfilled through the land covenant in Deuteronomy 30, the Davidic covenant in 2 Samuel 7, and the new covenant in Jeremiah 31:31. So specifically then, the writer to the Hebrews is arguing that Christ is and will be the fulfillment of the Davidic covenant. And what was that? Remember, God promised to David in 2 Samuel 7 that he's to have a child who shall succeed him and establish his kingdom, that Solomon would build the temple, that the Davidic throne should not be taken from the David, that David's house, throne, and kingdom would be established forever. Now, we really didn't get a lot of other information other than this, and it wasn't until the time of the New Testament, during that time when Mary conceived Jesus by means of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the angel comes to Mary, Gabriel, and he says, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and give birth to a son, and you shall name him Yeshua," or Jesus. "And he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David." This is a reference back to the fulfillment of that Davidic promise. "And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." So when does he take on the kingdom? When does the kingdom become enacted? Well, we know from having studied Revelation last year, that in the book of Revelation, God the Father gives God the Son, this is, occurs in Revelation 4 and 5, the title deed to the earth, the seven seals, that the Son begins to open, which causes the judgment upon the earth. That is, he is preparing the earth for his coming rule and reign. So John the Revelator picks up on this. Notice what he says in verse 1 of chapter 5 of Revelation. "I saw in the right hand of him," that is God the Father, "who sat on the throne, a book written inside and on the back." This is a scroll, "sealed up with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the book and to break its seals?' And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the book or to look into it. Then I began to weep greatly because no one was found worthy to open the book or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, 'Stop weeping. Behold, the lion that is from the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has overcome so as to open the book and its seven seals.'" Which really begs the question, who is the lion that is from the tribe of Judah, and who is the root of David? Well, that question is answered for us in the text itself. Recall back in the Old Testament again. Let's go back to Jacob. He's about to die. We know what he promises Joseph, the promise of the inheritance, that is the firstborn. He also blesses all of his children, that is the other 12 sons. When he comes to his son Judah, he makes this declaration. He said, "Judah, your brothers will praise you. You will grasp your enemies by the neck. All your relatives will bow before you. Judah, my son, is a young lion that has finished eating its prey. Like a lion, he crouches and lies down. Like a lioness, who dares to rouse him? the scepter will not depart from Judah. Now, get this, by means of the Holy Spirit, he's making a statement about contextually his immediate son Judah in front of him, but it also has implications later on for the ultimate son that would come from Judah, that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from his descendants, until the coming of the one to whom it belongs, the one whom all the nations will honor. So Jesus is the lion from the tribe of Judah. In addition to that, he's also the root of David. Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, the prophet Isaiah says this, out of the stump of David's family will grow a shoot, yes, a new branch bearing the fruit from the old root. And the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, and the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, and the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And then the exclamation point on this, the root of David, the line of Judah, Jesus himself said, Revelation chapter 22, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright and morning star. So what is the point then of the author in Hebrews raising this issue here in verse 5? Pentecost then notes, while some angels were appointed as principalities and powers and were assigned to rule the angelic realm, none of them were ever called sons. Oh, sure, there's five instances where angels are referred to as the sons of God, mostly in Job, but we find it in Genesis as well. So they are created beings, but none of them, even though they are the sons of God, which is a reference to angels, none of them were ever called son in terms of receiving an inheritance. None of them were ever promised to rule. None of them were ever promised to reign over God's creation. This authority, notes Pentecost, belongs exclusively to the resurrected one, Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the Son and the Messiah, but we see in verses 6 and 7 that he's also, that is the Lord, also is superior in his ministry. That is, that as the lessers, that is angels worship him now and will visibly worship him in the millennial kingdom. That is, when Christ rules and reigns on the earth. Notice what he says in verse 6. And when he brings the firstborn into the world, that is, when he again brings the firstborn into the world. So if Christ already came the first time, and if Harold Honer's dating system is correct, that Jesus was born sometime between 5 and 4 B.C. in the winter, that here he's speaking of his second coming, that is, his return. The first time he came to offer a sacrifice for sin, the next time he comes, it will be to rule and to reign. So the author makes an argument here based on the Greek translation of the Old Testament or the Septuagint. This would have been a Bible that Jesus and his disciples would have been using during this particular time. And so the play on the words in the translation is something that the author to the Hebrews used to help substantiate his argument. And I'll show you what I mean. So if you look at Psalm 97, for example, Psalm 97, verse 7 says this, let all those be ashamed who serve graven images, who boast themselves of idols, worship him, all you gods. Now, it's translated as gods. He's referring to angels, but the Hebrew word for angels here is Elohim, which means God. In the Greek translation of the Old Testament, this is what these writers translated it as. He says, let all that worship graven images be ashamed, who boast of their idols, worship him, all ye his angels. So what they did is instead of using Elohim, they translated over in the Greek language to the word angelos, which means messenger or angels. And so that's the word that he's pulling up out of the text there. and using that to substantiate his argument here in the book of Hebrews. Dr. Earl Radmacher notes, when he again brings is a reference to the second coming, the angels will worship the Son when he is enthroned as the king over the entire earth after taking revenge on his enemies and restoring his people. Also, in verse 7, we see that as the lesser, the angels are transitory in how they conduct their ministry. In other words, Jesus has an eternal ministry. He will always be priest, always be prophet, always be king. No angel has ever had that kind of ministry. Certainly no angel has had a ministry where they have engaged in that, in it perpetually as a ruler or as an office of something that only the Son can do. Look at verse 7. And of the angels, he said, who makes his angels winds and ministers a flame of fire? Here quoting from Psalm 104. Pentecost notes, because angels are spirit beings, their ministry cannot be observed. And just as a flame is temporary and transitory, so the ministry of angels is periodic and temporal. Most important here, the author contrasts the unseen and temporary ministry of angels with the eternal character and ministry of the Son. So, what's he trying to labor in making this comparison? Simply this, that no angel has ever had the throne, no angel's ever had a kingdom or scepter of authority. And no mere human ruler has an eternal kingdom or perfect righteousness. The Son of God has all of these. He is morally superior to all other creatures, humans and angels. And so, again, you have to put yourself in the first century Jews. This is the stuff that they would have known, things that we generally don't know. For example, we don't use the Greek translation of the Old Testament. This would have been a common Bible for them. So we're a little bit out of pocket in terms of the cultural implications of how they lived and what kind of Bible they used and what they thought in terms of the theology of angels at the time. Why that's important for us is really the same argument, though a little bit different in terms of the cultural stuff, but it's this. Life out there is hard, but don't give up on God. Don't walk away from the faith. There's really no place to go. I mean, the same thing was said by Peter over in John chapter 6. Jesus is preaching and teaching. A lot of the disciples were turning away from him. John notes that at this point, many of his disciples turned away and deserted him. Then Jesus turned to the 12 and asked, are you also going to leave? And Simon Peter replied, Lord, to whom would we go? You have the words that give eternal life, and we believe and we know that you are the Holy One of God. So there's no place to go. Moreover, we need to look at the things going on in life through a theological lens, that kingdom of God lens. We know, for example, by looking at the book of Revelation, that every time a seal is opened, it issues forth in judgment upon the earth. So we have to understand this, that as we see the things and the preparations for this time known as the tribulation period, where Christ will unveil the seven seals, that everything that comes to this earth comes from his hand. He knows how to protect his own during that tribulation time, and he knows how to protect us as we prepare for that tribulation time. So be of good cheer. Be encouraged, because we win in the end. The most important thing for you this morning is simply this. Where do you stand in relation to the King? Where do you stand in relation to the Savior? Do you know him as Lord? Have you trusted in him for the forgiveness of sins and eternal life? Or is he distant from you? Do you know him as a judge? Because if you do not repent, do not confess, do not believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, then you will meet him as judge. One poet, really a pastor from the 1600s, said this. He said, a man may go to heaven without health, without riches, without honors, without learning, and without friends. But he can never go there without Christ. So I want to give you an opportunity this morning that if you've never made a personal, conscious commitment to believe and trust in Christ for the forgiveness of sins and eternal life, that you do that right now. And that as you walk out those doors, you can be assured that when God's next event on his timetable occurs, and that would be the rapture of the church, you will be going. In other words, you're not going to be left behind to face the wrath of the Antichrist and the false prophet. So I would encourage you to do that today. Because again, as the writer to the Hebrews says, he's the only way. Even Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to me or the Father except through me. What he's saying there is not just a declaration, though it is that, but it gives for us the path to walk, because without the way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. And without the life, there is no living.